Hi, and welcome to sunny San Jose. It's Advancing AI 2025, and I'm here with no other than Mr. Keith Strier, Senior Vice President of Global AI Markets at AMD. Keith, welcome today. Yeah. Keith, look, we're at an amazing event for AMD today. What was your first impressions leaving the auditorium? You know, what were your thoughts on what Lisa and our guests presented?
I thought today was like a celebration of technology innovation. And it wasn't just a run through of new products, and there were some great announcements, great features, great inflections on the roadmap. But it was much more than that, because if you take it as a whole, we were really telling a much more powerful narrative of not just that we have new products, but the company is bringing systems to the market that solve complex problems for the benefit of society. I mean, it's a much bigger message, right? And actually, even more than just engineering brilliance is the commercial innovation that wraps around it, the relationships with our close partners, the joint ventures, the ways we're going to market. I mean, just the overall narrative was very, very exciting.
Yeah, it's, you know, when we talk about the narrative and we talk about the excitement in the room, the energy in the room, I was taken aback by the word open. And I think it's kind of weaved like a thread through our strategy. Maybe let's talk about AMD's AI strategy for a second. Maybe can you kind of break it down for us?
Yeah, well, you know, AI is not one thing, right? It's this constellation of different technologies and domains. And so it's hard to break it down and to oversimplify it, but there are some really sort of underlying themes that are important. And that is this sort of this battle of closed versus open, right? And if you look at the history of AI and you see at its proliferation, it actually proliferates, it drives forward mostly when researchers and entrepreneurs and creators and even countries can collaborate, right? And that requires not just open source, it requires open architectures, open ecosystems, right? So you really have to make an all-in commitment to that idea. And AMD stands apart. It just does. It isn't just convenient. It isn't part of the strategy. It's fundamental to the strategy. And having had many engagements with customers, partners, and countries as part of my role here, I know it's really important to them.
And let's talk about the latter, something you just said there with regards to countries. There's a big buzzword in the industry at the moment, sovereign AI. We're seeing a lot of narratives, coming to bear at the moment around sovereign AI. Yeah. A lot of people don't understand what it means.
Yeah.
Can you explain it for our audience?
Yeah.
What sovereign AI is?
So it's at its most fundamental level, artificial intelligence is not just another technology. It's a general purpose technology with transformational impact across society. Right. Because of that. Because it now plays a role in civilian life and the economy, in every sector, in government, in entertainment, in medicine, you know, you just go down through the list of every possible fragment of, you know, fraction of society, it's too important to think of it just as technology. It's actually important to the sovereignty of a nation itself, right? It's important to both the prosperity and the security of a nation. And this realization has taken a number of years to sort of bubble up, but there's uniform understanding about this now. And so sovereign AI is this idea that countries have to lean into building domestic capabilities around AI, compute being one of them, right? But also talent and these other things, right? And altogether, domestic AI capabilities are one of the key drivers of growth and resilience going forward. So it is now a national imperative, basically everywhere.
And it just let's touch a little bit more on that as well. You know, for the citizens of nations, right, who are looking at AI and hearing all about it, and then hearing their governments and nations getting involved, what's the benefits for AI for citizens?
Yeah, well, I mean, if you're a young person and you're in school, right, this is the future of the economy. This is what jobs are going to require, right? AI will affect and shape through the kind of jobs, right? But if you're in high school or you're in college and you're not aware of these technologies, if you're not literate, mm-hmm. and then trained in them to some degree, you could be a STEM major. You can go all in on data science and computer sciences, or you could be, you know, in more of a profession. But AI is going to be instrumental no matter what you do. So it's important to them. And then, of course, if you look across every segment of society, you want access to this technology because it's going to create the new competitive advantages, and it's going to help you lead. It's mm-hmm. going to help you create more revenue, more profit, deliver better services. It'll help you, you know, find better candidates for jobs and so forth. So across the board, you want to partner with your country to do that because it helps everybody.
And you know, one part of the public engagements that really excites me is around research.
Yeah.
And you know, Lisa today spoke about the over 40 sovereign compute engagements that we have ongoing, and some of them are with some of the biggest research institutes.
Right.
Is there anything from that that we can all learn from?
Well, yeah. So look, if you go back, I mean, supercomputing is not a new field, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, really, supercomputing goes back decades, right? But they were really instruments of scientific discovery for a very narrow set of scientists doing very, very specific things, right? Most researchers, most academics did not need or have access to a supercomputer. But today, every field of science, every field of academia, I mean, it doesn't matter if you're an economics professor or you study, biology or agriculture or even music, every field of academia is computational in nature.
Yeah.
And AI will play an increasing role in all of those. And so, for a nation to stay cutting edge, for a nation to lead to create the discover the next vaccine for a pandemic or to discover that something's even happening within your population to be worried about, right? To create a new generation of batteries, the power EVs, whatever it is, all of these things, the transition to green energy, it will not be possible to do that without having significant compute and the capabilities to run AI on them. So those are the two factors for all of those things.
And, when we talk about our strategy again and we weave in AI and we talk about sovereign, why is AMD considered a trusted partner in sovereign AI?
Yeah, honestly, the together we advance culture, which of course is our motto, that is felt deeply and authentically by the companies and the countries we work with. And when you're talking about sovereign AI collaboration, we're talking about creating not just a supply relationship where you're selling chips to a country, but you're actually joining up with them to help them advance their national AI goals. Your ability to partner in a very authentic way, your ability to say, well, let's co-design this roadmap together, not just here's my stuff to buy. It makes a tangible difference, and we're seeing that play out.
It's like skin in the game, it's like a partnership.
Right. That's right.
And speaking of partnerships, I think one of the nice conversations today was with Tariq Amin, the CEO of Humane,
from
the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. Can we talk a little bit about that joint venture and what we're trying to achieve together there?
Well, again, the kingdom is unique for a number of reasons, right? They have had a very forward-thinking approach to AI as a nation for several years. And that's not a given. I mean, there are countries across the world that are leaning in, but not everyone's doing it the same way, and not as visionary as they have. So they started out with a very strong vision, and then they've started to execute and implement that vision. And that transition from just having a strategy to actually execution, that's a big step. Not every country has done that as well. Some have, but the kingdom stands out, right? And they when they approached us, they said, look, we don't just want technology. We can buy that, from any partners, and they have a very diverse portfolio. I think that's a good thing. But we want to do something else. We want to actually partner to create something that only we can create potentially. We want to create a hyper-competitive, hyper-efficient global AI cloud based in our kingdom that could serve the world, that could truly disrupt the total cost of ownership of AI inference in a way that actually makes AI more accessible, more inclusive, and ultimately spurs innovation, both within their own country and then around the world. And I mean, that's very exciting for us. And I think they recognize in us a truly authentic partner to do that. And of course, we're also working with Cisco in that partnership as well. And so I think we're going to create something that's quite special. And we're very appreciative to Tariq and the leadership team to join up with us on that.
Well, Keith, I'm very excited about the future, working with you as well and in our engagements in the sovereign area. Thank you very much for your time today. Really appreciate it, and enjoy the rest of your day.
Awesome. Thanks.